Jesus. We thank you, God, for saving us, Lord. We thank you for those who have committed their lives, Lord, to you, Jesus. You are good, God. Oh, you are good. We stand in awe of you. God, you are so good. We exalt you in this place, Jesus. We exalt you in our lives. We exalt you in our family, Lord. We exalt you in our workplace, God. We exalt you in our relationships, Jesus. We exalt you in our schools, Lord. Oh, be exalted, God. Be lifted high, be lifted high, be lifted high. God, we bless your holy name. We bless your holy name, Jesus. We thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. No words can express how much we thank you, Lord. No words can express how much we love you, Jesus. Because of who you are and because of what you have done, God, we are grateful, we are thankful, God. For who are we, Lord? We are nothing but a speck. But God, you chose to save us. You chose to love us, Lord. We thank you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We bless your holy name. We fix our eyes on you, God, and as we continue to worship you with your word, we pray, God, that you would open up our hearts, you would open up our eyes to what you have in store for us tonight. We bless your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah, church. Bless his name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's take our time, 2 to 3 minutes, to welcome one another. You know, tell them God bless you. It's good to see you in church. Welcome the family in the house of the Lord.
Test mic. Good evening. Welcome to church. Man, that was a powerful worship. Amen. Thank God that every time we lift him up, his presence comes. Amen. And he blesses us with his presence in a real way. That's an awesome theme, the goodness of God. Amen. God is so good forevermore. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, I'm excited this week because three of our pastors celebrated their anniversary. It's an amazing sequence that the Lord, we celebrated it on the 19th. And then Doc Rowley and Pastor Amy celebrated it on the 20th. And then yesterday, Pastor Marty and Doc Rebbe celebrated their wedding anniversary. Amen. Amazing. I don't know what it is with April, why pastors get married in April. Close to Easter, right? Close to Easter. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles with you, we are going to continue in our series on Christian living, and tonight we are going to be talking about God's point of view on marriage. How many of you married? How many of you want to get married? Those of you who are singles, you want to get married. Oh, you're married already. Two hands and a foot, right? I will not ask how many of you want to be out of marriage? No, you're too late. You're there already. Amen. So if you have your Bibles with you, can you open it with me to Ephesians chapter 5? We're going to be reading from 22 to 33. And I'd like to use this passage of scriptures to be our text. You ready? How many of you brought your Bibles? Hallelujah! Brought their Bibles. I brought my Bible. My Bible, the fonts on my Bible are getting too small for me now. So that's why I use bigger fonts on the text. Amen. If you don't have your Bibles, please read with me on the slides. You ready? Wives. Wow. Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be to their husbands in everything. All the husbands said amen. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and blameless. All the wives said, amen. So husbands ought also to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I'm speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Nevertheless, each individual among you also is to love his own wife even as himself, and the wife must see to it that she respects her husband. Let us pray. Father, we are so thankful, God, for your presence in this place. We are so thankful, Lord, that whenever we come and we gather and we worship, Lord, you manifest yourself in a real way. Lord, I thank you that you have designated and dedicated this time, Lord, for us to listen to you. Lord, for us, Lord, to hear your word. Lord, I pray that the message, God, this evening, Lord, would speak to our hearts. Lord, just like what the Apostle Paul said, that as your word is, you breathe your word, Lord. It's God's breath. Breathe, Lord. I pray that you would use it as a breath of life for each and every one of us, as a fresh breath, oh God, for each and every one of us, Lord, that it would be inspired to our understanding, it would be illuminated to our understanding by your Spirit, Lord, that it would be a source of teaching, correction, rebuke, Lord, and guidance, Lord, so that we may be equipped, Lord, to be disciples of you, declaring honor and glory to you through our lives that we live. Lord, we'll be careful to give you all the praise and thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. How important is God to marriage? How important to God is marriage? So many people today just want to get married according to their own desires, according to their own design, irrespective of the design of the Creator. In our text, Ephesians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul used the words husband and wife a combined 14 times. Can you believe that? I don't know if you counted. I counted it when I read it and used it. And he mentioned husband and wife a combined 14 times. He used the word Christ, Savior, Lord, 7 times in that same context. So when he used the word husband-wife, he also used the word Christ, Savior, and Lord 7 times. That tells me that for every couple, God is there 1 time. Amen? That's 14 over 7, 2 over 1, right? That's the ratio. So that's, even with the text, even, you know, I'm not sure if this is my holy imagination only, or if it was a God-breathed inspiration in the Scriptures, built into the Scriptures, that God wants the reader of Ephesians chapter 5 to know how important a husband and wife relationship is to one another. He wants to be there. You know, in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12, it says, the Lord... I'm sorry. Can you go to the next slide, please? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 12 says, there are two can defend themselves. Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. Can you... reverse one time, go back to that. This is a cord of three strands. If you twine two pieces of strings together, the bond of that string will be very weak. That's why you need a third strand in order to make that binding like a rope and strong combination. There's a third strand that's needed. In marriage, Jesus, God, is that third strand. Amen? Go to the next slide, please. There. If you will look at how entwined the three strands are, you will see they were just not twisted. They were braided. They were braided together. And that braiding produces a stronger, tighter, sturdier, less breakable bond between those strands of rope. When we invite Jesus into our relationships, our weaknesses will be strengthened by His presence in our relationships. Amen? Those of you, well, we heard that testimony earlier, those of you who were not here, there was a couple that shared their testimony that they've been married for more than 20 years, I think, 25 years, he said, but the first 3 years of their marriage was enjoyable. They were in the honeymoon period. How many of you have been married more than 5 years? How many of you are still in the honeymoon period? There, June is still in the honeymoon period. How many of you have passed the honeymoon period? Well, June is in the honeymoon period, but Shine is past the honeymoon period. That's unique. I'm teasing. but many of us who are married know that there is a certain period in the beginning of our relationship that things are rosy-colored. Right? You know, your eyes are still sparkling. You know, romance is still in the air. She wakes up very early and she makes you breakfast. Or sometimes the husband makes you breakfast and brings it to bed. Breakfast in bed. But there are times after so many years of getting married, it's gone. And so there are times the courtship, the initial romantic feelings and relationships of the relationship sometimes fades. That's why God does not want us to love based on feelings. He wants us to love based on a commitment. Amen? Based on a decision, because feelings come and go. There are times you feel like you love. Especially if you're away and you have not seen your spouse for quite a while, a week or two, when you come home, wow. I don't know if David was able to sleep when he went home to the Philippines. He has not been back with his wife for many months, right? But amazing. how sometimes that emotions comes and goes. When you wake up one morning and you see the person's laying beside you in all her glory, no makeup. I've seen this funny film clip. Man, the girl was so pretty, so beautiful, right? After the wedding, they went back to the room, and she started removing her makeup, taking off her false eyelashes, taking off her false nails, fingernails, taking out her wig, taking out the pads back here. I don't want to say it. She does not look like a bride anymore. but many times, you know, if we base our relationship on emotions and on feelings, our relationship will not last. Amen. That's why it's so. It's so irrational to hear someone say, "I've fallen out of love with you." You cannot fall out of love. Amen? Because if love is a commitment, if love is a decision that you make, you don't allow emotions to affect it. Amen? When you made your decision to go to work and signed that contract, you know, for your employer, with your employer, no matter how difficult the job may have become, even if like Joe, you're assigned to be the starter, the opener at 2:30 or 3 o'clock in the morning, so he could monitor the priming of all the machines in the Vita. I don't want to wake up that early. You can't. You made a decision, right? And so you set your alarm clock and say, "I will decide to wake up because I will lose my job if I don't." That's just a job. The person you're married to is a treasure that God has entrusted to you. Amen? So you cannot fall out of love. Well, there are three things that I'd like to share with you this evening about... Oh, no wonder. There you go. The principles of marriage must be taken from the Bible to ensure its success. Many marriages fall apart because husbands and wives do not know the biblical concept of marriage. What does God teach about marriage? Let's look at God's point of view on marriage. Number one, marriage is a godly covenant. Amen? Marriage is a godly covenant. In Malachi chapter 2, verse 13 to 14, God was rebuking. I know you know Malachi, the book of Malachi, for tithes and offerings, right? Well, it's not just for tithes and offerings, it's for marriage. It's in that passage of scriptures that God says he hates divorce. Next slide, please. Marriage is a godly covenant. Look at this, Malachi chapter 2, verse 13 to 14. "This is another thing you do. You cover the altar of the Lord with tears, with weeping, and with groaning, because he no longer regards the offering or accepts it with favor from your hand." Look at this. God is saying, you come to the altar of the Lord with tears, with weeping and groaning. Man, sounds like a Pentecostal prayer meeting. Right? Sounds like someone who comes to the Lord in prayer with groanings, too deep for words, with tears and you know, with cries for their needs. Yet in verse 14, and Malachi continues, "Yet you say, For what reason? Because the Lord has been a witness between you and the wife of your youth, against whom you have dealt with treacherously, though she is your companion and your wife by covenant. God did not say that she is your wife because of a contract. It's a covenant that God considers the marriage relationship to be. Well, from the passages of scriptures, we see that an answered prayer and lack of favor from the Lord is a result of mistreating our spouse. Ooh. Did you catch that? An answered prayer and lack of favor from the Lord is a result of mistreating our spouse. You have dealt with your wife, the wife of your youth, treacherously. And so no matter how you cry and you weep, your prayers are not answered. Number two that we find here is the Lord witnessed. Go back. The Lord witnessed our wedding. The Lord has been a witness between you and the wife of your youth. Look at that. It's not just the pastor. It's not just the people that you invited and you fed, you know, during the reception. The Lord is a witness to your marriage. When you said yes to one another, when you exchanged marriage vows with one another, God heard you. God saw you. Hello. You know, recently I received a video clip from the Philippines. This was because of they're trying to pass the divorce law in the Philippines. Someone, Bubble Gang came up with a funny video, and they said their proposition was, since it takes a ceremony for couples to get married, it should take a ceremony for couples to divorce. And so they had a divorce ceremony, just like they're being married. They walk down the aisle, you know, the pastor is there waiting for them, and then they have the exchange of retracting their marriage vows. I don't love you anymore. And all of, in sickness and health, never mind. And then they exchanged rings back. They gave their rings back, and then they knelt down, and they took the veil off, they took the cords off. They returned the coins and whatever else ceremony. They blew out the candle. They lit their own candle, yeah, and then they blew out the unity candle. They're reversing the marriage ceremony. And then they were pronounced singles by the pastor. You can go back and... And we'll get to this a little bit later. When God said that the two shall become one flesh, the word that they used there was two pieces of paper glued together. And when you try to separate those two pieces of paper, it's going to be impossible. Because part of this paper will go with this paper, and part of this paper will go to this paper. You can never get them back to where they were originally. But one thing that, when I was reading this, you know, in the definition of the covenant that God was pointing out here, I realized that He was not just a witness. God was not just a witness to our relationship. He is the one to whom we make a covenant with as man and woman. Hello. I want that to sink in a little bit. God is not, if He is the third strand in that cord, He's not just a witness to our wedding, He's there. If you sign the marriage contract, the marriage application, when you sign it as husband and wife, the pastor who is performing the marriage ceremony signs it. Amen? Hello? When he signs it, he's not signing it on only his behalf. It's not just for legality purposes. He's signing it in behalf of the Lord. Hello? And so when you make that covenant, you make that covenant with God. A marriage contract, this is a difference between a contract and a covenant. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. There. A marriage contract is something two people sign with one another with a witness. A marriage covenant is signed by a man and a woman with God as the other signatory. Hello. Marriage is God's plan, not just a human idea. We cannot redefine marriage according to our own standards, according to our own concepts. When God said it was between man and a woman, it is between man and a woman. You cannot juggle it up, and you cannot mix up the cards and try to come up with different combinations. It will never work. You know, husband and wife, man and woman, in itself, God's design is so difficult for that relationship to work already without God in it. Much more getting married to someone outside of God's design. The covenant of marriage calls for a lifetime commitment between the man and the woman until death separates them. God commands the husband and the wife to submit to one another and to the lordship of Christ first. Next slide, please. Have you seen this poster or saying in any home? Christ is the head of our home, the unseen guest at every meal, the silent listener to every conversation. Amen? If God is not present in a home, it will not work. Hello? If we don't use the principles of God in our relationships, the covenant will break up. That's why young people, singles, make sure you follow the principles of the Lord. If you want a blessed home, a blessed marriage, then go to the designer of that relationship. It was God who brought man and woman together. It was God who saw man's loneliness. That's why Eve was created, and vice versa. Hallelujah. It's a covenant. It's not just a contract. Number two, marriage is unity. Matthew chapter 19, verses 5 to 6 reads, "And Jesus said, 'For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh.' So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate." This is a response that Jesus gave the Pharisees, the people, the scribes and the Pharisees during that time in the early verses of Matthew 19, when they were asking him, why did Moses allow divorce in the first place? And Jesus said, it's because of the hardness of your heart. But in the beginning, it was not so. This was not the design of God. And he said, this is the reason why a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife. Amen. I'm thankful for in-laws, for moms and dads who allow their children, their married children, to stay with them in the home. But according to the scriptures, that is not God's design. Parents, I know, like me and my wife, we had some years that we had to stay with my parents when we were starting. We could not afford to live on our own at the start. But you cannot stay that way together because that is not God's design. God's design is to leave and cleave. For the man to leave his father and mother, likewise the wife leaves his father and his mother, and they shall become one flesh. You know why it's impossible for the children to live with the parents? Whether it's the combination of you're living with the wife's parents or you're living with the husband's parents, there can never be two kings or two heads in a household. There could never be two queens in a household. There will always be clashes. Amen? So to avoid the clashes, get out of there. Otherwise, the fullness of God's design for you as a husband, as a wife, will never be realized. Amen? The goal of marriage is oneness, unity in all aspects of the relationship. Next slide, please. There's commitment to the following preserves the unity. Number one, letter A, unity in the spirit. There has to be a family altar. There has to be a time when you and your wife and your children, if you have children already, devote time together, praying, reading His Word together. Amen. There has to be a unity in spirit. Letter B, there has to be a unity in the mind. Honest and open communication between husband and wife, parent and children. Ephesians 6, 1 to 3. We'll look at that a little bit later. In Genesis, the Word of God says in Genesis chapter 2, verse 25, if I'm not mistaken, it says, the man and the woman were naked and they were not ashamed. It was not talking about the physical nakedness, but it was talking about the openness of communication. There was no hiding. You know, if you heard the testimony earlier, she was saying they attended a marriage seminar where you have to divulge everything to the spouse, and so that there will be a clear communication, so that there will be no hiding. Because you know what she said? She said, if there's something that's being hidden, something that's in the darkness, that's a place where the enemy still resides. Darkness. All negatives develop in a dark room. Hello? Letter C. Unity in the body. Physical relationship of the husband and the wife, the sex, the affections. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4 says, let the marriage bed be undefiled. Because of the presence of children here, I will keep this part PG-13. But we have had seminars before in the past where we discussed this extensively. Let me say that. Because most of the time, the sources of our education when it comes to the physical aspect of intimacy in marriage comes from ungodly sources. Amen? And so a lot of times the inhibitions, the hang-ups are there, and man and woman cannot enjoy the fullness of the design of the Lord. Letter D. There has to be a unity in the vision. Embracing the calling of God for your family, for your marriage, for your home. The husband and the wife needs to understand what God's vision is for their family. Did you know that God has a plan for your family? God has a plan for your family. And as husband and wife, you talk about it. There has to be an agreement between you. If there is no agreement between you, then that house will collapse. The only way you can agree is when you're basing it on the same standards, which is the Word of God. Letter E, there has to be a unity in finances. Faithful stewardship of God's blessings. Finances are not to be the basis of who rules. You know, some people have applied the golden rule in marriage. He who holds the gold rules. Or she who brings more gold rules. That is not the meaning of the golden rule. Unity in finances means that you are both acknowledging that you're stewards of God's blessings, God's provisions. And as such, your home is a place where stewardship is managed well. Amen? You know how to earn and how to disburse the finances that God blesses you with according to His standards. Last week, we were talking about tithes and offerings. You know, when Sister Ruth and I were starting in our relationship, it was really tight. After we gave the tithe, what's left was tight. The budget was tight. I remember back then we always had a deficit during the early days, right? We always had a deficit of about pesos. That was 200 pesos back then. A deficit of 200 pesos a week, and that's why we were. Our budget, our food budget, because when you work out your finances, of course, you remove the tithe first 10%, first fruits, right? Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Take that away. That's the Lord's. And then missions. If God told us and laid it in our hearts to support missionaries, we put that second. Third, offerings. And then our regular expenses, like house rental, things that needs to be paid for regularly. The last thing on the budget was food. Amen? Because that's adjustable. And so we remember that after we calculated everything, our food budget lasts us only from Monday to Friday. Saturday and Sunday was forced fasting. Either we had water, or if there are leftovers, but back then we didn't have a refrigerator, so everything was cooked and prepared daily. We didn't have a gas stove. We had a charcoal-fed stove. And so when we cooked our meals back then, we started with the viand first, because it takes high heat to cook, right? And then after that, we cook the rice, because by then, the charcoals will start to die down. And so it was just right to cook the rice. But God has been so faithful. I know Sister Ruth has shared this before, that there was one time we didn't have anything. I went to clean up the church with the singles, and she was invited to teach the choir of another church. And so by lunchtime, I excused myself from the singles group. These were all professionals, and they were inviting me to go to lunch. So I said, sorry, Sister Ruth and I have an agreement that we will eat lunch together today, whatever lunch will be. So I went home. She was not there. There was nothing to eat. And so I laid on the bed and started praying. Few minutes later, I heard a knock, and it was her. She came. She arrived, and she had a brown paper bag in her hand, and she was crying. She said, "Papa, look at this." We opened it. There were enough rice and viand, you know, a dish to share for both of us. But not only that, she pulled out something in her from her bag, from her purse, and she said, "Look at this. Guess how much it was? Our deficit. It was 200 pesos." And that the Lord just sustained that provision until the time that the church was able to increase the allowance that they were giving us, enough for us to be able to overcome the budget deficit until the children started arriving, and then, you know. But it was a wonderful experience. It was a wonderful experience when you know that God will supply when you follow His principles. Amen? There's a lot more stories, but I know it will take me more time. Number three, marriage is a responsibility. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 and 25 says, "Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her." There's a responsibility of the wife and of the husband. The wives are to submit themselves, to respect their husbands in all things. Amen? But only in the Lord. Amen? Only in the Lord. Meaning if what your husband is asking you to do is not according to what God's word is saying, then you can disobey him. Amen. And then the husbands likewise are to love the wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her. You've heard me share this before. When the husband and the wife get entangled and could not agree, according to that verse, who gives up? Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up. Ouch. Leadership in marriage is not by machismo. It's not by how much money you bring into the relationship. I believe that according to this verse, the success of a marriage, of a home, of a relationship is based on the Christ-likeness of the husband. There are no henpecked husbands in the scriptures. In Tagalog, walang underdisayang asawa sa Bible. That's Tagalog for henpecked, David. There's only Christ-like husbands. Amen? Amen. Who are willing to give themselves up. They said that Some say that your wife is the cross that you have to carry. That's right. But you're not just supposed to carry the cross. What did Jesus do? He died on the cross. Hello? He died on the cross. He died to himself, to that burden that he's carrying. Ouch. Is that biblical, Pastor? Just read the passage again. Christ gave himself up. When the church was rebellious, when the church was disobeying him, when the church was disrespecting him, Christ died for the church. Hello? I know the wives would love me after this, and the husbands would kill me after this. Pastor, why are you teaching that? Well, it's the Bible. Proverbs 22, verse 6 also says, there's a responsibility for the parents to the children. Train up a child in the way he should go, and even when he is old, he will not depart from it. I want you to see the relationship of that training up a child, training up of a child, to the relationship of the husbands and the wives. There is a direct relationship that training our kids, our children, through the relationship that we have with our spouse. No matter how good of a Bible teacher you may be, if wives, you cannot submit yourself to your husband, husbands, you cannot love your wives. Even if you have a doctorate degree, the training of the children will not work. Adherence to the biblical commandments of God to the husband and the wife is the pillar to a successful marriage and godly family. If the husband and the wife fulfill the functions God gave to each of them, the marriage will be strong and lasting, and both of them will be happy. We always hear this, happy wife, happy life. Well, sometimes there's a tinge of selfishness that pinches us, so we just make the wife happy all the time. Well, realign your thoughts. Realign your thoughts. If what makes you happy is something that feeds your ego, you're not in that relationship in the right way. Because love is not a 50-50 deal. I give you 50, you give me 50, and that makes 100%. How many of you know that works in marriage? Does that work in your marriage? If you give 50 and she gives 50, it works, it's 100%? Boo. It doesn't work. Because most of the time, you don't give 50. You don't even give 40. Sometimes you just don't give. You just want to take, right? So you know what marriage is? For me, basically, I understand marriage to be, it's not even 100%. It's 150%. You give beyond what you're able. That's what Jesus did. He gave beyond. He gave himself up. So that whatever the other person lacks will be compensated by your contribution. Amen. Hello? Amen. Are we getting that? Amen. Amen? Amen? So it's not just happy wife, happy life. If your happiness is making your wife happy, then you're both going to be happy. You just don't want your wife happy just to make a show out of it so that we will have a good marriage. No. Brothers, adjust the way we think. Adjust the way we relate. Let our happiness be Christ's happiness. The definition is Christ's happiness. What made Christ happy? When he gave himself up so that you and I may be forgiven and live and have eternal life. Next slide, please. Husband, love your wife. The highest need of a woman is love. If you can listen to some of the marriage counseling that we have gone through with couples, not just here, but in many other places, the wife is considering separating from the husband because the husband is not a loving husband. Let it be. Wife, submit to your husband. The highest need of a man is respect. Amen? If your husband cannot get respect at home, those who respect him will pull him away from you, wives. Letter C, parents, train your children in the ways of God. Parents are the first and daily teachers of their children, especially in their formative years. Children, respect and obey your parents. This is a command with a promise of a long life. Hello? Here you go. Next slide, please. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may be well with you, that you may live long on the earth. Next slide, please. You cannot enter God's covenant of marriage and make up your own rules as you go along. He defines it. He wrote it out. He gave it for our instruction. If we don't use the principles, if we don't try to learn the principles, you don't go to Bible study, you don't read your Bible, you don't listen to Christian radio, you don't attend seminars, you just want to make up your own rules for your home, it will not last. Hello? Can you go to the last slide, please? The last slide. I saw this in Pastor Marty's and Doc Rebbe's home. It says, our family will love and accept one another. Our family will pray for one another. And there are verses underneath it. Our family will tell the truth to each other. Our family will be kind to one another. Our family will bring joy to each other. Our family will serve one another. Our family will be patient with each other. Our family will comfort one another. Our family will forgive one another. Our family will be generous with each other. And lastly, our family will honor each other. I don't know where they bought it, but it's a good not just a decoration, but it's a good piece that needs to be in our home as a reminder for us of what the rules and the regulations and the principles are in our homes. Amen? As I close, can you go back to the previous slide? I don't know if you can. Can you read it? Here's a covenant of marriage that we can use. Recognizing that we serve a covenant God, our marriage is a covenant contract, and that we are commanded to live covenant lives. We do solemnly agree to this covenant of marriage contract, husband's covenant. I covenant with God and with you to create a marriage in which I will love, lead, guide, and protect you. I will nourish and cherish you. In response, the wife will say, I covenant with God and with you to create a marriage in which I will love, help, honor, submit to, and respect you. I will encourage and strengthen you always. And then the husband and the wife says together, we covenant to create a marriage relationship which mutually benefits the needs God put within each of us. We covenant to create a shared vision of hope, trust, and loyalty that will model our faith in Christ for our family. We covenant to give and forgive, always striving to make choices which empower and equip us to live godly lives. I'm aware that in our congregation, there are those whose marriages may have ended. Did not live through the design for which God has intended it, has designed it. There is grace. Amen? God is gracious. Even though it has happened to us because of maybe a wrong choice, wrong response that we have made, God is gracious to forgive and heal us. The principle is, don't go quickly to another relationship without understanding and recognizing what you need to bring into it. Amen? For it to work, don't jump from one relationship to another without applying the principles that God designed marriage to be. Otherwise, you will just go from one broken heart to another. Amen? Amen. Sadly, the children suffer. The children will suffer. But God is gracious, and He heals. Amen. And He gives second chances. Amen. He gives third chances. Amen. He gives fourth chances. He gives fifth chances. Bible says, Peter asked the Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother? Jesus said, 70 times 7. Amen? He is the God of the 70 times 7th chance. He will always have a fresh start available for you should you make a mistake. Amen? Don't make it 70 times 7, especially in marriage. Amen? Singles, choose godly men and women. It is not a plaything. If you are able to talk, some of you are probably from homes that have been victims of divorce. Divorce is not the working of the husband and the wife. No, it is not them who divorced. It is the work of the enemy that tries to separate what God has joined together. Hello? Amen? Amen. It's the work of the enemy. So children, if you see mom and dad, if you hear mom and dad arguing, don't get frustrated. Go to your knees and pray. Get down on your knees and pray and ask God to come in between and heal whatever difference there may be. Husband and wife, if there's something that you cannot get along with, apply the principles of God's word. Amen? Amen? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's a heavy message, right? But I'm thankful that even though the message is heavy, I have a good ending. The good ending that I have is last week we had 10 products of godly marriages and godly homes who made decisions for them to follow Jesus. I believe that they have seen through their parents godly examples of what a Christian is supposed to be. That's why they made their decision I want to follow Jesus as well and make Him Lord and Savior. So I'm going to give out the baptism certificates of those who got baptized last Sunday. Amen? I think Pastor Ricky called some of the other children. I'd like to ask Alyssa Bracero to come. Congratulations. God bless you. Can you stay? Can you stay? Jalen Joy. Gone. Here they are. Catherine Australia. Congratulations. Cassandra Isabel Furlow. Tiffany Bell, gone. Jacqueline Ann Kimusing. Naomi Ann Pikiko. Can you move over? Can you move over? Ivan Joshua Vidalion. He's the only thorn among the roses. Jody Denise Vidalion. And last but not the least, Marie Antoinette Vidalion. I know the parents are wanting to take some pictures, so we'll hold it there. Make sure you smile. Last Sunday, during the baptism up there, the presence of God was so strong. You know, when I stepped into the water and it was warm, right? I'm thankful it was warm. It was not cold. Because I had to stay there the whole time. The three of them leaves me every so often, right? After every three or four, they leave me there. But I'm thankful that I was there to witness the decisions that each of these young persons have made. Amen? They have seen, parents, they have seen your life. They're an answer to your prayers. And like what I said last Sunday, when teenagers and children like them outside of the church seek the world, seek after worldly fame and worldly things, our children at New Hope seeks the Lord. Amen. Amen. Our children loves the Lord. The reason why I know is because they have very sensitive hearts to the Lord. When they stepped into the water, they started weeping. They fully understood the decision that they were making. Amen? 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 So it's not playtime, it's decision time for the Lord. Now, let me just say this. I'm just blessed with Marie. Her mom sneaked into her room. Was it this morning or yesterday? Yesterday morning. She didn't know, but she woke up her mom. She was worshiping. She was worshiping on her own, having her devotions, and it woke up her mom. And mom took a peek in the room, and she was there worshiping the Lord, reading her Bible and singing worship unto God. Amen. What an amazing transformation. And I think God spared you, you know, from that, the testimony of mom with that accident, right? God spared you. When you worship Him, His presence comes and envelopes you and protects you. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, our newly baptized brothers and sisters in the Lord. Amen. Congratulations. Thank you so much. God bless you. It's offering time. Given to the Lord.
Let's pray for our tithes and offering. Father God, thank you, Lord. Thank you for all your goodness. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for the provisions that you've been pouring out upon us, O Lord, every day. And Lord, we just lift up to you our tithes and offering. Bless this tithes and offering, O Lord, and we pray, O God, that you will just use this for the furtherance and the glory of your kingdom, O Lord. Use this, Lord, to reach out those who are not saved yet, O God. We pray, O Lord, that you will just bless those who have given and bless those who have not yet who was not able to give today, O Lord. We pray, O Lord, that you will just touch their hearts and that you will just continue to bless us, O God. Bless this tithe and offering, Lord, for the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good afternoon. Together we can change this story. So I encourage you to invite your relatives, your neighbors, your friends to come and join with us. Thank you for being with us tonight, especially those who are first-timers. And also I would like to announce a quick announcement. I know you remember Brother Jun Cruz. He joined our Creator. And just to give you the schedule, on April 28th, Saturday, from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m., there will be a viewing. And on Monday, it will be the funeral service at 9 a.m. at Forest Lawn on San Antonio Drive in Long Beach. For more information, please ask Pastor Eric or Sister Eva about for more information, how to get in there. And hope to see you next Sunday. And invite your friends and don't forget to attend Bible studies. Some are doing it Thursday and some are doing it on Friday. If you have questions, approach our pastors, approach our Bible study leaders. Brother Glenn, Brother Art is not here. Brother DJ, me, myself, I'm also leading the Bible study. And for those who are interested leading the Bible study, you can approach our pastors and express your intention. Thank you and have a good night.
Someone is celebrating his birthday today. And it's yeah. Brother Bon. Yeah. Come on down.
Come on up.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Brother Bon. May the Lord God bless you.
One more time.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Brother Bon. May the Lord God bless you.
How young are you?
Let's
Let's pray for Brother Bong. Come on, come up here. I know there's a lot more this week who will be celebrating their birthdays. Pray for me. All right, Melanie, Nanay Virgie, Katie. Wow, there's a lot of April. Come on. All right, but today someone's celebrating his 30th birthday, so we like to umamin. All right, let's pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for Brother Bong, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God, for his life. Thank you, Lord God, for everything that you have done, Lord God, for him. And we're excited to see more things, Lord God, that you have prepared, Lord God, for his life. Lord, thank you for his ministry here at New Hope, for being one of the Bible study leaders and being the head of our guest services team, Lord God. Continue to bless him, Lord God, and his whole family. And continue to grant, Lord God, his heart's desire, Lord God, as he continues to seek you, Lord God, and to do things for your glory. Bless him mightily, Lord God, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Before we go, there are some announcements. This Friday is Youth Convention. Okay, so we are going to the Marriott. We are going to leave on Friday. So parents, I'll be texting you today for the schedule of the rides. I just need to know. I already know some who will be picked up, some who will be dropped off. But session starts on Friday. It is Youth Convention first and then Fine Arts the whole day Saturday. Okay? So if you want to come, I know some of the parents are planning to join us on Friday. On the evening services, you may come and join us. There's a certain fee for you to get in for those services. But Sunday morning, if we could all come and we could all join the celebration for the results of who will be advancing to nationals for Houston in July. Saturday, but Fine Arts is free for the whole day. Okay, you can go watch and the different presentation of the whole Southern California. Then, but evening services, you can join us also, but with a certain fee that you have to pay for the parents. The youth, they're already registered for the 3 days. And then we're staying at the Marriott in Long Beach, downtown Long Beach. Okay, so that will be a 3 day. Then we will all come back here Sunday just in time for the service. Amen. So pray for us. We are like 22 young people going. Okay, and we are excited to see how God will just move and minister to this group. There, you could still register for those who did not express their intention to come. There is still registration at the door. So let me know so we could squeeze you in and work out for everyone who can come. All right, let's all stand. Let's pray. Are there any more announcements? No more? Amen. Let us pray. We give you praise, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for this day. Thank you, Lord God, for the awesome move, Lord God, you have done in our lives. And thank you, Lord, that you are the source of our love, Lord God, and for each relationship, Lord God, that has been discussed, Lord God, between husband and wives and parents to children, Lord God. And to each one, Lord God, as we continue to walk with you, Lord God, may we continue to know, Lord God, each and every day that you are with us to guide us, to teach us, to rebuke us, to correct us. In all times, Lord God, when we read your word, you are there to speak to us, Lord God, and you breathe life, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, just continue to bless each relationship that is here, each couple, Lord God, each family, each household, Lord God. Lord, you bless them, Lord God, with your spirit, Lord God, just continue to move. Bless them financially, Lord God. Bless them, Lord God, with abundance, Lord God, that comes from you. And let there be peace, joy, righteousness, and harmony, Lord God, for every relationship, Lord God. Because we know, Lord God, what you have put together, no man, Lord God, could separate. Lord God, thank you for what you have done in our midst today. Bring us home safe tonight, we pray. We ask that you bless our young people, Lord God, as we go for convention this weekend. Pray that your awesome move, Lord God, and mighty touch of the Holy Spirit be upon them, Lord God. And for each person, Lord God, with their own respective needs, Lord God, we know that when we come and bring it to the altar, Lord God, and lay it at your feet, Lord God, you are the God who would answer and perform the miracles, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. We entrust all of these things, Lord God. For this we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen.